Welcome to the final video in a series looking at how BoJack Horseman experiments with form and structure. In the words of creator Raphael bob-waksberg, I am always interested in different ways to tell stories. Obviously, the underwater episode came from this idea of, can we tell a story without dialogue? Or can we tell a story from the point of view of the antagonist? Can we tell a story from this other character's perspective? Can we tell a story backward? Can we tell a story that just takes place in one room? Over my last two videos, I've demonstrated how some of the show's most inventive episodes use perspective and time to convey meaning. But I've also argued that the reason these episodes work so well is that they are each built around a strong central idea. This idea, which John Truby calls the designing principle, outlines the fundamental process that will unfold over the course of the story. And so in this video, I'll be analyzing the designing principles behind three of BoJack's finest half hours to show how they push the boundaries of television as a storytelling medium. As a Hollywood satire about a washed-up sitcom actor, BoJack Horseman is very aware of its own status as a TV show, often drawing attention to that fact through self-referential humor.
Audiences hate meta jokes. When will comedy writers learn?
Some episodes exploit this understanding to convey a deeper meaning. Escape from LA, for example, gives BoJack a taste of his ideal sitcom life, complete with a peppy new title sequence and three youngsters for whom he is made responsible. The return of the main theme after he ruins everything thus signals a reversion both to the show's usual format and to his old regular life. However, nowhere is this self-awareness more apparent than in the season 5 climax, fittingly titled The Showstopper. This episode is the culmination of BoJack's unhealthy comparisons between life and TV, with the premise being, Philbert is a hit and filming begins on season 2. But as BoJack spirals deeper into addiction, he loses his grip on reality. In terms of storytelling, this is arguably the series' most ambitious episode, as it combines the drug hallucinations of Downer Ending and That's Too Much Man with the non-linear chronology of Time's Arrow.
It's confusing, which means the show is daring and smart.
The episode is split between two genres, part tragicomedy and part detective drama, but it becomes increasingly unclear where one half ends and the other begins. The opening minutes are pure Philbert, from the What Time Is It Right Now credit,
What Channel Is Netflix?
To the previously on montage, to the comically hard-boiled title sequence.
They say the devil is a woman, but I ain't no clown.
From here, we alternate between scenes of Philbert and standard BoJack, with the distinction initially made obvious by the former's muted colours and vignette effect. But after an unexpected ad break, the two visual styles begin to bleed into each other's territories. And as the scene transitions grow ever smoother, it becomes almost impossible to tell the show from the show within the show.
This is not a TV show, okay? This is real life.
To understand the creative intent behind this confusion, I think it's important to consider the meta-narrative of season 5 as a whole. In one fascinating interview, bob-waksberg reveals that the inspiration for the season's storyline was his disappointment at his own agency's hiring of Mel Gibson. He also details a later incident that highlights his concerns about the show's impact. Someone who works with Will Arnett met Harvey Weinstein a year ago at a party, and he said, "You know, I love that underwater episode of BoJack you guys did." When I heard that story, the idea that Harvey Weinstein watched my show really gave me chills, and I thought, what's he getting out of it? Does he watch it and go, "Yeah, that's right, that's the way to be. Us Hollywood guys, we're trouble. What are you going to do with us?" Questions of authorial responsibility echo throughout season 5. From the dangers of real people identifying with troubled fictional characters,
I don't want you or anyone else justifying their shitty behavior because of the show,
to the wider cultural impact that media has on society.
It's a TV show. It doesn't glamorize anything, but maybe it normalizes it.
It therefore makes sense that the season climax should represent these fears taken to their worst extreme. The designing principle for this episode could be, blur the lines between BoJack and Philbert, both the shows and the characters, to demonstrate the normalizing effects of media on reality. BoJack functions here as both a problematic celebrity figure and an over-invested viewer, as his exposure to the character of Philbert throughout the season has caused his viewpoint to shift from
Philbert, he's a drunk, he's an asshole, I don't want to be him,
to,
and I think that that's what this show says, is that we're all terrible, so therefore we're all okay.
By this point, BoJack is actively using Philbert's flaws to justify his own substance abuse, which, in turn, is diminishing his ability to differentiate himself from the tortured fictional detective.
You're taking the character home with you.
His strangling of Gina at the end of the episode is the ultimate symbolic identification with the antihero, as life imitates art in the most horrific way possible.
See, that looks real.
On the surface, this episode's blending of genres serves to emphasize the convergence of BoJack and Philbert's characters. But on a deeper level, it reflects the ease with which media depictions of harmful behaviors can seep into reality.
It makes things normal.
The final image calls back to The Truman Show, another story about a man struggling to tell life from TV. But this time, there's no clear division between the two worlds. Often referred to as the underwater episode, Fish Out of Water put BoJack on the map of shows willing to experiment with unconventional storytelling. This episode takes the title character quite literally out of his depth, with the synopsis reading, BoJack takes an underwater trip to the Pacific Ocean Film Festival for the Secretariat premiere, where he tries to reach out to Kelsey. Bob Waksberg cites Sofia Coppola's Lost in Translation as an influence, commenting that the film says something interesting about the alienation of being a stranger in a strange land. Despite concerning itself with similar themes, this episode explores them in a very different way, namely by forgoing almost any trace of dialogue. The designing principle here might be, force BoJack into isolation to teach him the importance of connections. One of the most remarkable aspects of this episode is just how well the mechanics of its underwater world are designed to facilitate this idea. As Truby writes, to connect the story world and the designing principle, you take the rough sequence of the storyline found in the designing principle and expand it three-dimensionally. At first, everything about Pacific Ocean City serves to alienate BoJack, as it not only deprives him of verbal communication, but also of his usual coping mechanisms, such as smoking, drinking, snacking, and watching TV. This urges him out of the self-imposed isolation of his hotel room and into the bustling city, where his attempts to deliver a shallow apology letter to Kelsey are thwarted at every turn. After being pushed onto a bus by a school of fish, he's left stranded in the middle of nowhere, completely alone and without even one bar of phone signal.
I'm starting to think that smartphones are actually making us less connected.
The episode's second act sees BoJack embark upon a quest to reunite a lost seahorse with its father. Although he initially wants nothing to do with the child, he gradually warms to it, as shown through his facial expression just before they enter the taffy factory. It's in this moment that BoJack realizes the joy of interpersonal connection, which is precisely why he's so heartbroken when that connection is eventually severed. Watching the child hug its father's leg as it once hugged his, he now recognizes his
deep need to connect to the world at large,
but he doesn't quite know how to satisfy it. This change in character is most apparent upon his return to the city, where, instead of retreating to his hotel room, he stays downstairs to enjoy socializing. While the underwater world previously appeared to conspire against BoJack, it now opens up to him, as his connections with others net him all the nicotine patches and vodka suppositories he could ever want. The episode's lack of dialogue complements this transformation in several ways. Functionally, it leads to a series of miscommunications that increase BoJack's sense of alienation. Tonally, it gives the episode a stark, lonely quality. And thematically, it emphasizes the power of unspoken bonds between people, as summarized in his final letter to Kelsey when he writes, "In this terrifying world, all we have are the connections that we make." Comparing this to his earlier attempt, it's clear that he's finally pushed past his surface-level understanding of relationships and found something deeper.
These very rare brief instances in which you suddenly remember you can swim.
We now arrive at my all-time favorite TV episode, Free Churro. In direct contrast to Fish Out of Water, this episode's story is told almost entirely through speech, with the synopsis simply reading, BoJack delivers a eulogy at a funeral.
Here I am, BoJack Horseman, doing a eulogy, let's go!
Despite its rambling, disjointed format, this 20-minute monologue possesses a definite narrative structure. Speaking about the challenges of writing the episode, Bob Waksberg says, "We did a couple of things. We watched an episode of Maud with her just talking to a therapist for a full episode.
I stole it from an episode of Maud.
And while writing Free Churro, it was very helpful for me to think about it in terms of A, B, and C stories, so it's not just this stream of consciousness thing."
It's just stream of consciousness.
He expands on this in another interview, stating, "We have the idea that the last thing BoJack's mother said to him was,
I see you.
And the mystery of what that meant kind of became our A story. Then you could kind of wander down digressions and various cul-de-sacs, but we always came back to that home base." BoJack's investigation into the meaning of Beatrice's dying words forms the spine of the episode, while also serving as a branching off point for many of the seemingly unrelated anecdotes littered throughout. After his first couple of attempts to make sense of the words, the possibility that they were meaningless leads into his story about a horse in a round fan.
And maybe this is like that coffee cup. Maybe we're dumb to try to pin significance onto every little thing. Maybe when someone says, I see you, it just means, I see you.
The idea that she could have been talking to his father then segues into the tale of Butterscotch's death.
Maybe she saw my dad. My dad died about 10 years ago of injuries he sustained during a duel.
Next, his recollections of his mother's dinner parties circle back to yet another potential meaning.
All three of us were drowning and we didn't know how to save each other, but there was an understanding that we were all drowning together. And I would like to think that that's what she meant when we were in the hospital and she said, I see you.
And finally, the realization that she was merely reading the intensive care unit sign leads to his Becker analogy.
And when it got canceled, I was really bummed out. Not because I liked the show, but because I knew it could be so much better, and now it never would be. And that's what losing a parent is like. It's like Becker.
The designing principle for this episode could be, over the course of an impromptu eulogy, BoJack unravels the meaning behind his mother's last words and comes to terms with her death. At the start of his monologue, BoJack is still holding out hope that Beatrice might show him some sign of affection from beyond the grave.
Even now, I find myself waiting.
This hope is the driving force of the episode, and is ironically the very thing that leads to his hopes being dashed when he discovers the truth. By the episode's end, BoJack is forced to accept that his mother was nothing more than the abusive, vindictive parent she appeared to be, and that he was nothing more than the disappointment of a son she made him out to be.
Suddenly you realize you'll never have the good relationship you wanted. And as long as they were alive, even though you'd never admit it, part of you, the stupidest goddamn part of you, was still holding on to that chance.
And of course, because this is BoJack, this revelation causes him to internalize his father's detrimental advice from the cold open.
You can't rely on other people, BoJack. It's good for you to know that. No, it's good to know that I am the only one that I can depend on. And I know that now, and it's good. It's good that I know that.
Free Churro is a perfect example of how a strong designing principle can allow writers to subvert narrative conventions according to the specific needs of their story.
No show should have that much talking. TV is a visual medium.
Sometimes, when a character's journey is purely internal, the best way to tell their story is straight from the horse's mouth.
My mother is dead, and everything is worse now. Because now I know I will never have a mother who looks at me from across the room and says, BoJack Horseman, I see you.
More than almost any other show, BoJack Horseman loves to test the limits of television as a storytelling medium. Whether the writers are twisting genre conventions to examine the nature of TV itself, or venturing to the extremes of the audiovisual spectrum, the results are always great stories that feel as if they couldn't have been told in any other way.
I knew this show would bring us to the heights of human drama more powerfully than literature ever dreamed.
Over my last three videos, I've looked at how the series deals with trauma, deception, depression, death, life, addiction, dementia, normalization, isolation, and grief, not just through content, but through form and structure as well. Far from being mere gimmicks, these narrative experiments are always motivated by theme, with every aspect serving to reinforce the designing principle at the core of each story. As screenwriting guru Robert McKee writes, the more beautifully you shape your work around one clear idea, the more meanings audiences will discover in your story as they take your idea and follow its implications into every aspect of their lives. This show has proven meaningful to hundreds of thousands of viewers, and I don't think it's a coincidence that these particular episodes consistently feature on people's top 10 lists. With that in mind, I want to take a moment to thank the writers of these incredible stories: Joanna Callow, Alison Taffel, Elijah Aaron, Kate Purdy, and of course, Raphael Bob-Waksberg, for making it all possible. If you enjoyed this series, feel free to leave a comment or a like, and consider subscribing to the channel for more in-depth story breakdowns like these.